we're going to help community groups, such as many of you in the room, figure out how to spread the wealth. So we have an incredible events portal on the website that will list every event in Brooklyn. And to add to that, we are going to have chamber staff over the summer send out a survey to every nonprofit group in Brooklyn, basically asking you, when is your event? When is your gala? When is your golf outing? When is whatever? We will then compile a list and then get back to you and say, hey, X nonprofit, I just want to let you know on this day, there are three other galas. You may want to do it the night before so that you can really spread the wealth. Denise, my board chair, is smiling because she's been asking for this for a long time. But anyway, so we decided, since it's Brooklyn, it's the hottest place, the coolest place, the most fun place, that we would have a video that kicks off Explore BK. So without further ado, let's show you Brooklyn. So now I hope that gets you in the mood to rock and roll in Brooklyn. By the way, the participants are all Brooklyn Chamber members. So just to be clear, you have to be a Chamber member to be in the video. Okay, so let's get started with this morning's show. First of all, of course, a special thank you to Investors Bank for being our exclusive sponsor. Give them a big round of applause. They are truly incredible and tremendous supporters of all of Brooklyn, and not just the Brooklyn Chamber, but so many groups in Brooklyn. And you're going to hear from them in a little bit. Obviously, today we've been able to assemble an incredible group of organizations and individuals that are making things happen all across the borough, and we could really not have done it, Domenick, without Investors Bank. So please give a round of applause again to our friends at Investors Bank. St. Francis College, President Brendan Dugan, one of our board members who you'll hear from a little bit. Rob Oliva, you look very casual today. After graduation, please give St. Francis College a round of applause. They do great things in Brooklyn. Thank you to the Chamber Board of Directors. Our board chair, Denise Arbesu, who is here. You'll hear from her soon. They are truly a dedicated and engaged board, and they work very hard both in their professional jobs and in what they do for the Chamber. Of course, thank you to our ambassador team, co-chaired by Deborah Rodriguez and Daisy Dobbins. Deborah and Daisy, are you in the room? There you are, okay. Thank you for working so hard this morning. And of course, I get to stand up here and give a great speech and smile, and we all do, but the work is done by an incredible staff at the Brooklyn Chamber who have really put their heart into all of this, particularly Rick Russo, Joe Shia, Jordan Buglione, and Antonina Agrusa. So let's give them a round of applause. Thank you for your work. And they have been working with Jennifer from Investors. So Jennifer, I know you're going to miss visiting us all the time. Jennifer, where are you? Why are you hiding back there? You should be like sitting up front. So really the summit is an opportunity for Brooklyn to come together, for the nonprofit industry to get together as a group, to discuss common issues, identify best practices, and develop solutions. And let me just remind everybody that the nonprofits of Brooklyn are an economic engine of Brooklyn. They create jobs, they pay salaries, and they spread the economy with wealth and knowledge. So thank you to all of you for being one of Brooklyn's biggest economies. So thank you. Let me just recognize also our former board chair, Peter Meyer, who's in the room. Peter, thank you for being here. So today you're going to hear a great panel, you're going to have some breakout sessions, and you'll have a truly amazing keynote speaker who I'll talk about in a few minutes. And then of course you will have a networking lunch where we hope you will talk about best practices and continue to network and get to all of you. So, to begin our program, let me welcome the chair of the Chamber's Board of Directors, Denise Arbesu, who's entering her second year in the role and is doing an amazing job. Let's give it up for Denise.
Good morning. Thank you, Carlo. I really just, wow, I'm overwhelmed how many people are here today. And this is all about you. So I really appreciate investors for being here and all of you, the not-for-profit industry, because without you, there would be no compassion, no service of the, what I call the underserved. And I am always amazed by what you do. And some of you for such little money. So thank you, you know, for all that you do for Brooklyn. And obviously it is acknowledged in terms of the economy, as Carlo just said. I'm here representing the board, and I really, again, thank you for your continued support. Without you, we wouldn't be here. And I do want to do a little shout out to one of our former chairs, and that's Phil Stenger. Phil, thank you for all you've done for Brooklyn. And thank you, Brendan. Enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you.
Thank you, Denise. We are, of course, in St. Francis. And I was actually here with Phil a couple of weeks ago for a wonderful Charter Day convocation. And it's interesting when you talk about universities in New York City. And of course, the big ones always get the press and the New York Times articles. And then you've got St. Francis College right in the heart of Brooklyn, which is serving an incredible array of students from all ethnic backgrounds, from all economic backgrounds, and they're doing an incredible job with it. So with that, let us welcome to the podium our dynamic president, Brendan Dugan.
Thanks very much, Carl. I don't know about that dynamic stuff. You decide. But we are certainly, as a community, happy to have you all here and to see the robust response to this idea, which was, I guess, the genius of Carlo and the Brooklyn Chamber, because we very much appreciate the work that all of you do in making Brooklyn the very special place that it is. What separates Brooklyn from the other boroughs, and you can look it up. I've been employed for 42 years in the city of New York and beyond, mostly in the banking industry, I would say. And I've visited all the boroughs, and I've been involved in community activities in all the boroughs. And by far, the most effective, dedicated, and successful group of not-for-profits is located right here. So give yourselves a round of applause for that. We are really delighted to be partners with the Chamber, which, you know, echoing the previous statement I made, is really the only chamber that functions and gets things done in this city. And of course, Investors Bank, who may be new to some of you, but they are a very dynamic and growing financial institution that really has at its core community engagement, banking the old-fashioned way by being involved with the people. Now, I say that, and in the interest of SEC and Sarbanes-Oxley type disclosure, I must tell you that I am happy to be a member of the board of directors of Investors Bank. So thank you. Thank you, Domenick. And I just want to refine one other statement that was made. The dean of all bankers in Brooklyn is here and was previously introduced. So not only is Phil Stenger a former chairman of the Brooklyn Chamber, but he is also now known as Dr. Phil Stenger, because at that convocation, we were happy to confer a doctorate on Phil Stenger. So there's Phil. Stand up, Phil. So there he is, folks. On behalf of everyone here, Phil, thank you for your dedication to Brooklyn, all things Brooklyn, and your success. So without further ado, I wish you all the best. We co-sponsor or host approximately 700 events a year for not-for-profit organizations here at the college. Some of you may have some needs with respect to space or anything else. And if there's any way we can be of assistance to you and the good work that you do, that's what we're here for. We are here to educate young people first and foremost, but we also practice the longstanding Franciscan value of hospitality. So we hope you're comfortable and happy here today and have a successful day. And we hope you'll think of us as a good partner as you discharge your duties in whatever branch of the not-for-profit world you sit. So thanks, welcome, have a great day.
Thank you, Brendan. As I mentioned earlier, today's event could not have been possible without the sponsorship and support of Investors Bank. And I know many Investors Bank senior management are here. I'm not gonna try and name everyone because I'll forget people, but why don't you guys stand and take a bow? Don't be shy. Stand. Biagio, you're allowed to stand. Anna, come on, good job, thank you. And I should say, Biagio Madeo is chairing our golf outing Monday, and there's still tickets. So see Biagio if you want to golf or have dinner or anything. And he's giving a major speech that night, right, Biagio? But let me talk a little bit about our next speaker, Domenick Cama, who serves as Senior Executive Vice President and Chief Operating Officer at Investors Bank. He is a Brooklynite, born and raised. He has been a really strong supporter in the last year and a half of all things Brooklyn. And I'm not just talking about the chamber, and we really appreciate your support of the chamber, but helping small groups out there like Regina Opera or other little organizations who might not be getting really what they should be getting because they're small and many people don't know about it. But Domenick and his team have gone out there and have looked at each organization, have not always gotten the limelight for it, have just given the support and said, enjoy it and just do good things. So I think that shows a lot, Domenick, about what you and your team are doing, your passion for Brooklyn, and how you're really stepping up to help Brooklyn's economy. So with that, let's give a warm welcome to our friend, Domenick Cama.
Wow, thank you, Carlo. Let me get my remarks ready. It's great being here. You know, this is our second opportunity to be a partner with the Brooklyn Chamber of this event. And, you know, I'd like to thank Carlo and the Chamber for the hard work that they have. I mean, it's truly what a difference you can see in this chamber with the commitment that they have to, as Carlo puts it, all things Brooklyn. And it is also my pleasure to be here as a born and bred Brooklynite. You know, I couldn't be prouder of all the things that are happening here. You know, Brooklyn is creating jobs. It's adding residents at a faster pace than any other borough in the city. And it has been across all sectors, you know, education, health, business, services, media, technology. You know, Brooklyn has become in recent years the epicenter of a locally focused but widely heralded economic scene. From a thriving digital internet industry in Dumbo, now known by some locals as Silicon Beach, to jewelry makers in Williamsburg and whiskey distillers in the Navy Yard. New Brooklyn-born businesses are springing up in every neighborhood. And right before our eyes, we're witnessing people from all over the world coming to Brooklyn and realizing that something that we as Brooklyn natives always knew, that this is a great place to work, to live, and most importantly, to raise a family. Investors Bank is also committed to Brooklyn. In fact, you know, I'll put a little plug in. We're opening our 13th branch in Brooklyn in the Brighton Beach section of Brooklyn Saturday. You know, I We were there last night, had a little event, and it's just simply amazing what's gone on over there. Our mission is to continue to be a community bank. Now, you know, you may ask the question, how does a bank with $18 billion in assets, the largest bank headquartered in New Jersey, how do we become a community bank, or how do we remain a community bank? Because we believe in making a difference. We make differences for our communities, for our customers, and our employees. You see, we want to be known as the bank that brings community back into banking. And like all of you, we understand the essence of community, its heart and soul, is the value of things we do as individuals and organizations to make it a better place for everyone. It's not enough just to be successful. You need to be significant. And you can achieve significance by giving back to others. And as part of our commitment to Brooklyn and its nonprofit sector, we've established the Investors Bank Charitable Foundation that since 2010, I am proud to say, we've distributed over $10 million in grants. In Brooklyn alone, we've supported the Brooklyn Institute for Arts and Science, Mamamides Hospital, Opportunities for a Better Tomorrow, the OHEL Children Home and Family Services, the Regina Opera Company, and the Brooklyn Cultural Center of New York, just to name a few. And most recently, you may have heard that the bank did a second step capital raise in which we raised approximately $2.2 billion in new capital at the company. And our shareholders approved the contribution of an additional $20 million to our foundation, bringing our total endowment to approximately $60 million. We can do a lot of good in Brooklyn. And, you know, you saw some of our folks here today. I'll encourage all of you as nonprofits to talk to some of them about our Care to Share program, which is a program that's designed to be able to give you, as nonprofits, another revenue source from investors. You know, we understand that not-for-profit organizations are critical to a growing economy. They bring a unique expertise and perspective on issues that impact businesses and individuals. They add to the vitality and quality of life. And so we at Investors Bank salute your work and leadership. You see, at Investors, we believe in the importance of being leaders who serve rather than self-serving leaders. We all know that successful organizations have leaders who serve others. We also know that not-for-profit organizations are made up of leaders who serve, people who foster change and make our communities a better place for all. And that is why we are honored to support a conference specifically targeted to your community. Today, you will have the opportunity to hear from our keynote speaker, Darren Bloch, Executive Director of the Mayor's Fund to Advance New York City. This is a group that's working to promote public and private partnership to support public programs. In addition, as Carlo mentioned, we'll have a number of informative sessions that where you can get some tips and from experts about topics that can help your organization. And finally, you'll have the opportunity to network with those who face similar day-to-day challenges. At Investors, we realize it takes commitment, hard work, and a great deal of energy to have an impact, one which cannot be reached without the good work of the Brooklyn nonprofit community. I want to once again thank Carlo and the Brooklyn Chamber for allowing us to be a part of this great conference. We appreciate your good work and look forward to a long and successful partnership. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Domenick. And thank you for your kind words. As Domenick said, we have a really wonderful keynote speaker today, Darren Bloch. Darren is an attorney with both public and private sector experience, and he was recently appointed executive director for the Mayor's Fund to Advance New York City, a nonprofit organization designed to promote partnerships between the city and the private sector to support public programs. As executive director, Darren funds over 100 different programs in areas including the environment, youth development, health, financial empowerment, volunteerism, and the arts. Of course, when you get a busy guy like Darren, you give him another job. He's also working as counsel to the Office of Strategic Partnerships for New York City and overseeing the business affairs of that fund, working closely with the chair, the First Lady of New York City, Shirlane McCrae. With previous experience as Vice President for Public Affairs at New York Law School and Executive Vice President of the Empire State Development Corporation, Darren, who I am very pleased to report is a Brooklynite, yes, it is a requirement, Darren, is tasked with helping to build the New York that rises together. I have to tell you, Darren is a trooper because he didn't know he was doing this until about 24 hours ago, and he immediately rearranged his schedule, canceled appointments. I hope you didn't cancel on the First Lady for us, but if you did, that's okay. But he's here in Brooklyn and he's here to support us. So let's give a round of applause to a dear friend and a great Brooklynite, Darren Bloch.
And to be clear, I asked Carlo to really build up my resume so you didn't think they sent an urban fellow over here. So let me just be clear about that. Carlo, thank you for inviting me. Denise, Domenick, thank you as well. Thank you to Investors Bank for hosting this in St. Francis College. It was, and by the way, congratulations on Explore Brooklyn. I think that's just a wonderful resource for our borough, and other chambers should sort of look to that as a model. You know, when I was invited to speak on behalf of the mayor and the city, I welcomed the opportunity. It's a wonderful convening of nonprofits. It's the type of event that we should really be fostering frequently, more often. I know this is the third annual, and it's terrific to see them continue to go. So I've worked in government for about 20 years now, and when I was worked for the city council, worked for the public advocate's office, worked for state economic development and for nonprofits, including New York Law School. Dean Crowell is here with us today. You'll hear from him later. And when I was offered the opportunity to join the administration as the executive director for the Mayor's Fund and counsel to the Office of Strategic Partnership, my first thought was, and a lot of you probably share this, what the heck is the Mayor's Fund and what is the Office of Strategic Partnership? So I did a little research, and for those who aren't familiar, the Mayor's Fund is the city's primary nonprofit partner. It's a city-affiliated 501c3 focused on advancing the mayor and city agencies' sort of primary priorities, and really targeted in leveraging and launching public-private partnerships, raising funds to support high-impact programs, and really leveraging the deep well of civic goodwill that exists within our civic business community. Past and ongoing initiatives, just to put this in a little bit of perspective, include the Young Men's Initiative, Million Trees NYC, NYC Citizenship, and the city's Family Justice Centers. And I know many of the groups in this room are familiar and probably support a lot of these programs. As Carlo mentioned, First Lady Shirlane McCrae was appointed our board chair. And for those who haven't met her, she really is an extraordinary person. She brings a depth of knowledge and experience in government and policy, in the nonprofit sectors. She's worked in publishing. She's been a speechwriter for Mayor Dinkins and other electeds, and worked at Maimonides Medical Center here in Brooklyn. So she really is a remarkable partner as we set out our priorities and our agenda. And as it turns out, there are actually over a dozen of these city-affiliated nonprofits spread around city government. Other affiliates include the Fund for Public Schools, the Fund for Public Health, ACS has a fund, Small Business Services has a fund. And I bring that up to talk about the other role that I serve as counsel to the Mayor's Office of Strategic Partnerships. It's a new entity that was created really to set priorities and manage the activities, communication, coordination among all of these various nonprofits, really to make sure we're all rowing in the same direction, and for this community and the community of funders and others to make sure you have a clear sense of what the city's priorities are as we move forward. The effort is led by Gabrielle Fialikoff. She's a senior advisor to the mayor, and she's worked alongside the mayor for several years. I would say she probably understands his goals and priorities as well as almost anyone, except for maybe our board chair, his wife. So that's an interesting 1-2 punch that we have on our board of advisors. But really, in its simplest form, the organization is focused on maximizing opportunities, leveraging resources to support highly innovative, high-impact projects in our city. So getting back a little bit to my first thoughts when I was invited to take on this role, beyond obviously needing to familiarize myself with some of these entities, I was excited to join the mayor and his team because of the ambitious agenda that they've set. And we all know that agenda well at this point, I'm sure, bringing universal pre-K to the largest school system in our country, building and preserving 200,000 affordable housing units, developing workforce pipeline, and attacking pervasive inequities that have persisted in so many of our communities. But beyond the programs themselves, the mayor's focus is genuinely rooted in an understanding that our city is made up of communities. We are very much a city of neighborhoods. And so the work really needs to begin with investments in and partnerships with organizations supporting our neighborhoods. And that conversation pretty much starts and stops with the incredible fabric of non-for-profits in this room and beyond. So I would say that as important as many sectors in the city are, none, I think, are singularly responsible for holding our communities and our city together, together the way this network of nonprofits does. So all this is to say, we at a very core level, we value the importance, the diversity of our city's nonprofit sectors and systems. You are very much our partner as we launch universal pre-K and new workforce development efforts, as we work to increase summer youth employment opportunities, as we continue to support East Harlem and Sandy Relief, and there are many, many more like it. To give you a sense of just how much you help us, Carlo and others mentioned a few important statistics, but let me just say, the city contracts with over 1,800 nonprofit organizations, just an astounding number, and that represents $4 billion of investments that the city makes in these essential programs and services across the five boroughs, many of which you all support and help us execute. So, and as mentioned, the nonprofit sector is, of course, an economic driver in our city, employing more than 500,000 New Yorkers. And here in Brooklyn, actually, we're home to over 10,000 nonprofit entities. Almost 10% of Brooklyn's labor force is working at nonprofits. And this is interesting, Brooklynites give more to charity as a percentage of income than residents of any other borough. So clearly, we're also a very generous and caring people, which is fantastic. Absolutely, no, please. It's but given this vital importance, we wanted to make sure that we continue to bolster the nonprofit community with resources to grow, to thrive, because ultimately that'll help the city grow and thrive. So let me take a minute to give a little bit of background on some of the different resources that exist in city government for non-for-profits. And as starters, let me just say that every deputy mayor within our administration, from Deputy Mayor Barrios Paoli on through, several of which, by the way, come from the nonprofit sector, are all incredibly focused on joining and bringing you in as partners in what we're doing and thinking through our initiatives and thinking through our priorities and thinking through the answers and solutions to some of the challenges we're all confronting. But being a little bit more specific as well, I wanted to make sure that you're familiar that the city has a nonprofit assistance group that's dedicated to providing support services and helpful information directly for nonprofits. And this includes how to do business with the city, loan grant resources, trainings on fundraising and board member management, marketing guides, and more. You can actually see this at nyc.gov/nonprofit. I usually hesitate to give a web address because I'm not sure how many people are taking notes on it, but point is, you can Google it, it's there, you can find it, and I'd encourage you to track it down. There are also a couple specific programs, two in particular, that I wanted to highlight as a resource to nonprofits in the city. One is New York City Service. It's led by our new Chief Service Officer, Paula Gavin, and it's aimed at increasing volunteer recruitment, matching volunteers to initiatives and partnerships with nonprofits, and offering capacity building to support the nonprofit sector. Specifically, the group promotes and engages volunteers around some of the city's greatest needs projects. And nonprofits can register with New York City Service on their website and submit and post volunteer opportunities, and I'd encourage you to do so. In a similar vein, Greater New York is a small but impactful Mayor's Fund program that pairs business executives with nonprofit leaders. to provide high-level advisory support to organizations that are exploring new business opportunities and testing innovative business models. Through Greater New York, participants, participating organizations are examining new partnerships and earned income business streams. They're developing broad-based communication strategies and risk assessment tools to understand the real costs of the service delivery. So turning back to the Mayor's Fund for a brief moment, what I'd like to set out and let you make sure you're all aware is our set of priorities as we move forward. And really, they're aligned with the Mayor's. And part of what, again, the Office of Strategic Partnership is doing is making sure that not just the agencies and not just our nonprofits, but really everybody in the administration is focused like a laser on the key priorities that he set out. That's helping advance early childhood development, that's helping with health and mental health issues, that's helping with workforce development and jobs training, affordable housing, and really fighting these broad inequalities and disparities that exist in our neighborhoods. And the priority that we're going to be setting is not just programs that fit within these specific buckets, but we're going to be focusing attention on the programs and initiatives that touch multiple challenges at once. So that would look like bringing resources into NYCHA housing to help those in affordable housing with workforce development, with jobs training, with early childhood development services. That looks like bringing mental health and other healthcare resources into communities through community health hubs. So really what we prioritize are solutions and programs that work at cross purposes to really tackle neighborhood challenges and broad sectional challenges. So with that as background and a little bit of information, I want to just thank you again for inviting me to come and speak a little bit about the work we're doing with nonprofits. Over the weeks and months ahead, I'd encourage you to connect with us at the Mayor's Fund, connect with the Office of Strategic Partnership, and track down whatever city-affiliated nonprofit might be in your area of work and focus. So thank you again to Carlo. Thank you again to the Chamber. And enjoy the rest of the program. It's a great set of panelists.
Thank you, Darren. That was incredible. Thank you so much. And really, Darren, I know you're going to have your hands full, so please count on the Chamber, and I know all of our nonprofits will look forward to partnering with you and the work that you're doing. So let's give it up again to Darren Bloch. Thank you, Darren. So we have an amazing kickoff panel that we're going to hear from in a few minutes. The first panel is going to be on understanding the Nonprofit Revitalization Act, which I know many of us in this room are very confused about and have a lot of questions. So we're going to know everything about it within the next 30 minutes. The panel is being moderated by my dear friend and Chamber Executive Board member, Anthony Crowell. Anthony is the Dean and President of New York Law School and the Chair Emeritus of the Brooklyn Public Library. He took office at the law school in May 2012. His previous job, where I think many of us met him, was as counselor and really senior, I think senior advisor and everything else to Mayor Michael Bloomberg. He really led the management team and really oversaw all policy initiatives from Mayor Bloomberg. So we are excited about the panel. We know Anthony is going to give us some tough questions. So Anthony and panel, please join us up here. Let's give them a round of applause. And Anthony, take it on.
I want to acknowledge President Dugan and thank him for hosting us. And St. Francis is a wonderful institution and one which I'm very familiar. My old friend and mentor, Frank Macarola, who many of us miss very, very much, first introduced me to St. Francis, and I've enjoyed a relationship with many of its administrators and staff over the years, and it's a wonderful place, so thank you for having us. And as a Brooklyn resident and Chamber Executive Board member and an individual who's on the executive committee of the largest not-for-profit in Brooklyn, the Brooklyn Public Library, I want to give Carlo a great deal of thanks, as well as Denise. You have brought new life, a new energy, and a renewed commitment to Brooklyn, a place that I think is like none other on earth. So thank you, Carlo. I also appreciated that Darren Bloch was here, my friend and colleague. He just left New York Law School for the Mayor's Fund. And I thought he gave a really wonderful set of remarks and really outlined Mayor de Blasio's vision, but also really connected the work that all of us do here to the future of not just Brooklyn, but the entirety of New York City. It was great. So before I introduce our panelists and begin our discussion on the Nonprofit Revitalization Act, I want to just outline a little bit about what the act is and give sort of set the stage for you. So this is the latest effort to reform nonprofit governance, and it began in 2012 when Attorney General Schneiderman proposed legislation to streamline registration and modernize and enhance nonprofit oversight, as his office has the oversight of the state's nonprofit organizations through the Charities Bureau. The state legislature ultimately passed two bills that together incorporate much of what the Attorney General initially proposed. So here are the major components and reforms of the law, which go into effect this July. And they include simplifying nonprofit incorporation by reducing categorization of nonprofits into two categories and streamlining the filing process, enabling greater operational efficiencies, which include permission for nonprofits to utilize modern technology to facilitate board meetings and communications, revising and strengthening oversight and reporting requirements, which include enhanced conflict of interest and whistleblower policies, annual financial statement reporting, and new audit committee requirements, depending on the size of the organization. Also increasing restrictions and oversight on related party transactions, including mandating board reviews and increased authority to the Attorney General to void transactions, and then streamlining board procedures for real estate transaction approvals. And we will explore as much of this as possible with our fantastic panel. So let me walk through who our panelists are, and then we will get our discussion underway. The first of our panelists is Michele Arbeeny. She is a partner at the law firm of Windel, Marx, Lane and Mittendorf, and that's where she's practiced her entire professional career. Her practice is focused on representing financial institutions and nonprofits in real estate, commercial lending, trade and finance, and municipal finance transactions. She was born and raised in Brooklyn. She received her law degree from Brooklyn Law School, right around the corner, and received a bachelor's in history and psychology from Boston University, and she's on the board of the Brooklyn Arts Council and continues to live here. Next is another terrific attorney, Deborah Beyer. She is the principal attorney of a boutique firm that serves as outside general counsel to nonprofit organizations here in the city, with a tremendous number of organizations right here in Brooklyn. Her practice includes nonprofit and tax-exempt law compliance, contract drafting and negotiation, corporate governance, employment law guidance, higher ed law, and other typical responsibilities of an in-house nonprofit general counsel. Before she launched her firm in 2011, she was the general counsel at the New York City Department of Small Business Services. And she is a 1994 graduate of NYU Law School and a member of the New York Nonprofit Coordinating Committee's Government Affairs Committee and the National Association of College and University Attorneys. Next, we are joined by Laurence Scot, a partner at Scody, Scot & Company, CPA. Larry's company is a full-service Manhattan public accounting firm that specializes in servicing not-for-profit organizations, professionals, and closely held businesses. Prior to starting the firm, he held responsible accounting positions in the law firm of Shearman & Sterling, the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants, and Coopers & Lybrand. He has a bachelor's in political science from Queens College and an MBA in accounting from Pace and is certified to practice in both New York and New Jersey. And we also have another accounting expert in David Rotkamp, a CPA partner and a not-for-profit practice leader at Grassi & Company. David has more than 25 years of experience providing audit and advisory services to the not-for-profit industry. He focuses on nonprofit organizations, serving individuals with special needs, religious organizations, educational institutions, healthcare providers, foundations, and the arts and cultural world. And he's got a technical knowledge that allows him to provide specific services, including compliance audits and retirement plan audits. And he is a graduate of Pace and received a bachelor's in business administration in accounting. And finally, last but not least, is a professor right here from St. Francis College, Professor Robert Wu. And he is He teaches accounting and business law, and he is the assistant director of the college's Center for Entrepreneurship, a very relevant thing for many of us here in Brooklyn. Professor Wu began teaching courses here in 2010, and prior to that, he taught at Monroe College, and since 2001, he's held positions in business with Ernst & Young, Columbia Medical Center, and Deutsche Bank. So with that, he received his BS from the University of Akron, an MBA from Case Western, a Master's of Science from Penn, and a JD from St. John's. So with that, we're going to get started. What I think that we will do is break down the discussion between the lawyers and the accountants, but I'm going to ask Professor Wu to come up. I know that was a lot of the introductions, but we had to sort of define who everyone was. I'm going to ask Professor Wu to come up and give a broad overview of the act so we can tee up the rest of our panel.
Thanks so much, Dean Crowell. And so I just want to go through very briefly about New York's Nonprofit Revitalization Act of 2013, give a broad overview of what's going on. Basically, nonprofit organizations in New York, as you know, Domenick and Carlo mentioned, cover a broad spectrum of critical services that are provided to the citizenry, including legal services, child welfare services, child care services, substance abuse services, mental health services, and education, of course. And there's tens of billions of dollars from the state of New York that go into, in the form of contracts that go through to the nonprofits. And as Carlo mentioned earlier, it's a substantial economic engine in New York State as well. It was estimated by the New York Attorney General's office that one out of seven jobs are in nonprofit in the state of New York. So that's very significant. In recent time, there seems to be a kind of a reduction in the resources that are available to nonprofits, whereas the demand for their services has increased. So there's been this mismatch of kind of demand for services and the resources to provide those services. So the Nonprofit Revitalization Act really focuses on, as Dean Crowell mentioned, to try to streamline some of these procedures to make it less onerous for nonprofits to kind of operate in New York and make New York more of a magnet for nonprofits rather than creating more hurdles for them to be effective in the state. The themes are really kind of focused on, number one, reducing, again, as I mentioned, the processes for forming a nonprofit. Number two, making sure that there's effective oversight and strategic leadership for nonprofits. And also, three, kind of to make sure that the boards are able to properly govern with the tools that they need to make sure the nonprofits are oversaw correctly and that they're strategically leading them in the right directions. Traditionally, there's been a lack of skills, lack of time and commitment, lack of guidance and best practices among some of the boards, and there's really been inconsistent board participation among some of the nonprofits in New York State. So the law was designed to kind of improve those areas. Now, the Economic Revitalization Act was signed into law during December of 2013, and as Dean Crowell mentioned, over many, many years, this has kind of been in the works. And the act kind of reaches across many different segments of New York State statute, including the general business law, the banking law has been reformed, the education law, the Surrogate Courts Procedure Act, the estates powers and trust law were all amended as a result of the act to kind of, again, to streamline the business aspect of the nonprofits and how they form in New York State. The main areas of focus include in the amendments to the different statutes across New York State. The main areas of focus are restructuring the application for processing and dispersing government contracts to nonprofits in the state, reducing barriers, as Dean Crowell mentioned, to forming these nonprofits, making sure that nonprofits don't have to choose between whether they're a B type or a C type nonprofit, and making it just a lot more simple for nonprofits to form. We want to reduce some of the outdated laws with the amendments as well, because some of the laws, again, for instance, notice and waiver of notice for board meetings are not able to be done through electronic communication, such as email. So what we want to do is we want to make sure through the amendments that things like that, common sense things like that, are able to be done for the boards. We want to also improve, again, as I mentioned from the outset, nonprofit governance, which requires the boards to get more involved in the financial auditing process similar to their SEC counterparts. So we want to make sure that the boards are kind of overseeing and that they have an audit committee that are focused on the audits of the nonprofits. We want to make sure that they have participation, the boards, that is, participation in executive compensation, to make sure that those are reasonable, and bringing in outside consultants to make sure that there's not an abuse of executive compensation. And also enhance the abilities of the government to kind of monitor self-dealing and insider transactions, conflict of interest rules, and also whistleblower practices, so that it makes it easier for people to raise a red flag if there is one. So again, the changes in the law from the Nonprofit Revitalization Act of 2013 are really focused on, again, making it more efficient place for nonprofits to operate, encourage and support their worthy missions, and improve the oversight to reduce fraud and malfeasance among nonprofits.
Terrific.
We're going to start with Michele and Deborah. Can you both discuss in more detail how nonprofits should get into compliance with the law and how it relates to conflicts of interest disclosure, whistleblower protections, the bylaw amendments, and related party transactions?
So Anthony, Michele and I kind of broke up the legal aspects of this speech by good topics and bad topics. So what Michele's gonna do is she's gonna go through the parts of the Nonprofit Revitalization Act that essentially make your life easier, give you more flexibility in your board activities and in your notices and communications, and allow you to engage in certain types of transactions with less red tape. When she's done, then I'm going to talk to you about things like conflicts of interest policies, whistleblower policies, and related party transactions, which is the part of the law that essentially bolsters your oversight and accountability requirements. Hopefully there are things you're already doing, but there are some specific requirements that you'll need to know about going forward. So I'll turn it over to Michele for the good news.
This is the good cop, bad cop routine. I've seen this before.
Yes, I do have some good news for everyone. Well, I do hope that you take advantage of the Act's benefits, and I'm going to outline a couple of those. And streamline, I think, is the word. Streamline bylaws, streamline the process, and modernize your bylaws, and that's some of the benefits of the Act. So there are four particular areas that you should keep in mind, and you should review your bylaws to determine whether you need to, update your bylaws on these particular areas. First and most importantly, real estate transactions. So real estate transactions that would not constitute all or substantially all of your assets. The Act now permits boards to approve those types of real estate transactions by a vote of a simple majority of the board. So that is a relaxation of the higher threshold of two-thirds of the entire board requirement that most not-for-profits with less than 21 directors needed to comply with. One of the other benefits of the Act, not only relaxing that threshold to a majority of the board, but now a majority of committee board members can also make these types of determinations. That is new. So you want to take advantage of that in amending your bylaws and adding that component. And if a committee does approve this type of particular real estate transaction, the Act does now require that that committee must promptly notify the board of the approved transaction. One of the other areas that related to real estate transactions, which I'm sure some of you have had to do, is obtain Supreme Court AG approval for particular types of transactions for all or substantially all your assets or mergers and acquisitions. As many of you know, that could be a lengthy and tedious process. One of the benefits of the Act, it's now no longer a two-step process, it's a one-step process. So seeking AG approval is the only step that you need to do, so now not-for-profits do not need to go through the additional time or expense of getting a justice of the Supreme Court to approve a transaction. Another area besides real estate transactions are just committees. This is not all good news. The Act eliminates the differentiation between special and standing committees, and as many of you know, you had some more flexibility with special committees. They could be less than, could be one or two members, or if it was just for, a particular matter that you don't have, a lot of board support on. So at this point, if your committee is not otherwise specified in the bylaws, you can only form these committees by a majority of the entire board forming them. And in fact, no directors can be appointed to that particular board committee unless a majority of the entire board is present and votes on that particular board that board committee membership. Also, one of the fact that there are no longer special committees means now there is a minimum 3 board member requirement for standing committees, and they must all be directors. So for smaller not-for-profits, that's not great news because they may not have 3 directors that can be on, you know, many committees. But the act does allow the board to establish committees of the corporation. That's the phrase. And although the act specifically states that committees of the corporation don't have the authority, they don't really have authority rights, they can't make decisions, at least the act allows that if you set forth in your bylaws that an alternative procedure to not only have the committees of the corporation, but also to how to appoint members or other people who are not directors to those types of committees, which I'm sure many of you have individuals that are just assisting a not-for-profit that aren't on the board, but their voice could be well valued on a special committee like that, or I should say a committee of the corporation. And so you can set forth in your bylaws not only that you can have a committee of the corporation, but that the board chair or the president, or by just a routine vote, you can appoint individuals to those committees of the corporation. The next area is, I'm sure many of you in your bylaws have a description of the chair of the board or the office of the president. So you should take a look at that section, because now the act specifically states that no employee, including the CEO, if you have one, which you should, may serve as the chair of the board. So that's an additional, you know, prohibition. Or any other officer that has a similar responsibility cannot serve as the chair of the board. And for those not-for-profits, the smaller ones that don't have chairs of the board, and you have a president that may be acting in the same capacity, a president, for example, who chairs board meetings, you may have to comply with the same prohibition. That president, you know, no employee or the CEO may be the president of the board. And so, you know, we are certainly seeing not-for-profits in that particular provision adding the prohibition to their bylaws to make it abundantly clear that you can't have this crossover in roles. The last area, which Deborah briefly mentioned, are electronic communications. And this is part of the benefits, the modernization of the bylaws. So now, specifically, the Act says you're allowed, you know, to provide notices by fax, for example, email communications, and video teleconference for those larger not-for-profits that may, you know, want to take advantage of that. And there are 3 particular areas in your bylaws that, you know, would be worthwhile amending with respect to electronic communications. First, if you have members, notices now of member meetings can be delivered electronically. Also, proxies, that was not the case before, proxies now can be given electronically. If you happen to be a larger not-for-profit with members, with over 500 members, you can now post notice of your member meetings on your websites. And in addition, you have to continue to publish up until the date of the meeting. In a newspaper, publish not electronically, but in print. The second point on electronic communications is member and director action can now be done via electronic consents. And that's, you know, for boards that, you know, may not often meet or have a hard time with maybe some older board members, or if there's a sick board member who can't actually get to a meeting, if they have email capability, those consents or requests for consents and approvals can be sent out electronically, and those board members can now respond and electronic signatures are accepted. One thing I would note is that, you know, if you are going to utilize it, and I know in our not-for-profits, you know, we have, make sure that it's clear to board members that when they respond, maybe just saying yes or okay is insufficient. Maybe you want them to reiterate what they're actually approving, and always remember that those consents have to be filed in the minute book. So you may not want to completely take advantage of it on a regular basis, because it may be a lot of paperwork to keep track of, but it's something I think can be utilized if it's needed. The last area in electronic communications, as I mentioned, is video conferences. And there are some larger not-for-profits that do want board and committee meetings to be participated by video conference. And so in your bylaws, where it may say in person or by mail, the types of amendments you should be making would be and by email or by via video conference. Those are some of the examples.
Great, so onto the bad cop side of the equation. The Nonprofit Revitalization Act. Is that better? Can you hear me?
Okay. Maybe we should say benefits and burdens.
Benefits and burdens, okay, no bad cop for me.
On the burdens side, yeah.
So the Nonprofit Revitalization Act also strengthened and bolstered the requirements for nonprofits in terms of the accountability and the oversight that they have with respect to their organizations. It did it in three ways, and I'm gonna go over each of those separately. First are the procedures that you need to follow with respect to related party transactions. Second is the conflicts of interest policies that you are now required to have under New York State law. And third is the whistleblower policy, with which some organizations, not all, but some, are going to be required to have under the new law. So related party transactions, what are they? A related party transaction is any transaction, agreement, or any other arrangement in which a related party has a financial interest and in which the corporation or any affiliate of the corporation is a participant. So what this means in short order is if a director, an officer, a key employee, if they're entering into a transaction with the organization, or if the organization is entering into a transaction with their family member, or with an entity that they own or have a large ownership interest in, you're going to be faced with the related party transaction requirements. So prior to the New York Nonprofit Revitalization Act, you were already engaging in certain procedures around these types of transactions. The federal law, which is called the Excess Benefit Transaction Law, already sort of governed how you handled these types of transactions, but it governed it slightly differently. So now you're going to have to comply with both the federal law as well as this New York state law in how you approve and how you review and approve these related party transactions. So what do you have to do? The Act requires that any director, officer, or key employee who has an interest in a related party transaction disclose the material facts concerning his or her interest. So what that means is if you're on a board, if you're an officer, or if you're a key employee, and you think you may be you or your spouse or some entity that you're related in, may be about to or considering engaging in a transaction with the organization, you need to disclose that immediately. The board is then obligated to engage in an active determination about whether the transaction would be fair, reasonable, and in the best interest of the organization. If it makes that determination, then it can enter into the related party transaction, and if it doesn't, then it can't. Interestingly, under the law, for that general overall assessment, there's no de minimis exception. So that would apply to any transaction, even if it's small. There's an additional hoop that you need to jump through if you're a charity, which I suspect most of you are, and if the related party has a substantial financial interest in the transaction. Now, that term is not defined in the law, so we're hoping that the Attorney General is going to give us some regulations to explain what that means. But in those situations, then the law requires you to go through three very specific steps in order to approve the transaction. First, you need to consider alternative available transactions. And that's an important step. A lot of times, you find a vendor and you want to enter into a transaction with them. But if it constitutes a related party transaction, you're going to need to look at other options, and you're going to need to document that you looked at other options. The transaction has to be approved by no less than a majority vote. And you need to contemporaneously document your approval and the basis of the finding that the transaction is fair, reasonable, and in the best interest of the organization. in addition to the requirements that you have to go through, the new law now also gives the Attorney General extra police power. So the Attorney General can come in, he or she can enjoin, void, rescind any actual or proposed related party transactions. So even if it hasn't happened, he or she now has the authority to involve themselves. So related to the related party transactions is the conflict of interest policy that you probably already have, but now also need to have comply with New York State law. As you probably know on your 990, your IRS 990 form that you file every year for your taxes, you have to answer the question, do you have a conflict of interest policy? So most organizations do have one already. The IRS had previously issued a model conflict of interest policy that many organizations are utilizing. However, now that conflict of interest policy also needs to comply with the New York State law for conflict of interest policies. So if you don't have one, you'll have to create one. And if you do have one, you'll have to review it to make sure it also complies with New York State law now. And New York State law now has a very specific requirement of what needs to go in your conflicts of interest policy. In fact, it sets forth six specific things that need to be in your policy. One is a definition of the circumstances that constitute a conflict of interest. Two are the procedures for disclosing a conflict of interest. Three, a requirement that the conflicted person not be present at or participate in the deliberations or a vote on any matter. Four, a prohibition of any attempt by the conflicted person to influence improperly the deliberations or the vote on the matter. Fifth, a requirement that the existence and resolution of the conflict be documented in the organization's records, meaning your minutes. And finally, procedures for disclosing, addressing, and documenting related party transactions. So a couple notes on those. A lot of folks, when they're faced with a potential conflict or a potential related party transaction, want to hear from the party who may be conflicted out. So the good news there is that you can actually bring the person into the meeting and have them explain the facts behind them. They just need to recuse themselves when you go into deliberations and when you have your vote. But the law now is not just a federal law, it's a state law as well. And the state law also requires that you have a form, which you probably already have, but it's essentially the form that you have your directors fill out when they come on board, your board, and that they fill out then annually thereafter. The New York state law now actually mandates that that form exists and that they sign it, that they indicate which organizations, other organizations that they're involved in, and any transaction that the organization may be entering it, that the other entity may be entering into with the organization. Okay, almost done with the bad news, or the burdens.
I just want to mention on the related party transactions, to the extent that your bylaws have you may have called it an interested director provision, you may have called it something else. You know, you can rephrase those now to call them related party transactions, and instead of saying, you know, contracts between the corporation and an officer or employee, you may actually want to say, you know, contracts or agreements with the corporation and any related party as defined in the act. You can do that so that you don't have to keep reiterating and maybe you don't do it correctly. So you can actually use some of the definitions of the act in your bylaws.
Okay, so the third burden that I'm going to talk about is the whistleblower policy. The New York State law requires that certain organizations have a whistleblower policy, and that's those organizations that have 20 or more employees and annual revenue in excess of $1 million per year in the prior fiscal year. So if you fall into that category, you're going to have a whistleblower policy effective July 1 of this year. So it needs to go in your whistleblower policy. The New York State Nonprofit Revitalization Act has some very specific requirements about what you should put in that policy. It needs to provide that no director, officer, employee, or volunteer who in good faith reports any suspected improper conduct shall suffer intimidation, harassment, discrimination, or other retaliation or adverse employment consequences. So a couple points there. It covers volunteers, not just director volunteers, but volunteers generally. It also covers improper conduct, including fraud, illegal conduct, or violations of the nonprofit's policies. So that's a little bit of a controversial part of the law, because technically speaking, then it covers a violation of an HR manual. So every organization is going to have to figure out how they want to work that out with their policy. Essentially, if you have somebody complaining that another employee violated the provisions of your employee handbook, like your discrimination provisions or your sexual harassment provisions, you'll have to spell out somehow whether they're going to go through this whistleblower policy or if they're going to go through the procedures that are already in your employee handbook for handling those types of complaints. We are also hoping that the Attorney General is going to issue some guidance on that particular provision and how organizations can comply with it. In addition, the policy must include procedures for reporting actions or suspected actions. It needs to name a designated employee, officer, or other director to administer the policy and report to the audit committee. And it must be distributed to all directors, officers, and employees, and any volunteers who provide substantial services to the organization. So a couple thoughts there. You have to designate somebody to administer the policy. That might be the chair of your audit committee. A lot of organizations are doing that. It could be your CFO. It could be another senior employee. Some organizations even hire sort of outside hotlines to take whistleblower complaints, and that's okay as long as a director, officer, or senior employee is ultimately responsible for it. That person needs to be reporting to your audit committee on a regular basis about the whistleblower claim. So obviously if a claim comes up and it's an important one, they're going to take that to the audit committee, but they also need to be regularly reporting to the audit committee on the activities that took place under the policy. And some organizations are also requiring, let's say, annual reports to the board as well. And then the third part is the distribution of the policy. So it's interesting because some folks try to put these in their HR manuals, some folks hand them out to their directors, but it's important that you give it to everybody on the list in the law. So that's all of your employees, all of your officers, all of your directors, and any volunteer who provides substantial services to the organization, which of course is not defined in the law. So hopefully we'll get some regulations from the AG on what that means as well. One piece of good news with respect to both the whistleblower policy and the conflicts policy. There is a provision in the law that says if you have a policy already in place prior to the effective date of the law that substantially that you set up pursuant to federal, state, or local law that's substantially consistent with the requirements of the act, that you'll be deemed to be in compliance. Again, substantially consistent has not been defined. We're hoping for some more guidance on that. But it does give those organizations that have policies in place a little bit of time to convert those policies into policies that comply with the new law.
Okay. Terrific. Now we're going to turn over to the financial side of the house, and then I'll turn to Larry and David to discuss how nonprofits need to adjust compliance practices in terms of Charity Bureau registration with regard to financial statement, reporting, audit committee formation, structure, and other responsibilities.
The word accounting, right now you can stop closing your eyes because people start freaking out with the word accounting, but it's really not that bad. We're not going to sit and talk about real accounting issues. The way David and I have spoken before, and what we're going to do to hopefully keep you awake, is we're going to go back and forth on a couple issues that are related to the financial requirements under the new act. David, start off.
Thank you, Larry. It's nice to be here today, and I'm glad I'm not one of the attorneys. A lot of challenges, sounds like, and burdens. But we are pleased to be here to talk about the accounting and audit requirements as set forth in the Revitalization Act. And one of the things that was just mentioned is the registration process for nonprofits in New York State, and that hasn't changed. The Char 410 is still the required form if you're actively soliciting contributions of more than $25,000 in New York State. And as such, you're then registered with the New York State Charities Bureau and required to file a CHAR 500 form. That is the tax return form that is used by New York State. And the IRS Form 990 is attached to that CHAR 500 form, along with a copy of your financial statements. And those documents are public documents at the state level now as well. They're published by the Attorney General's office. They're posted on their website. Anyone can see any information relative to that. Where the law has now changed, effective July 1, is the thresholds for the attest function or the financial statement portion of the New York State filing requirement. The registration process is still the same, but the attest function is either an audit, a review, possibly a compilation, or no financial statement whatsoever. Under the old rules, if you had revenue of less than $250,000 as your organization for your reporting year, you were required to have at least a reviewed financial statement attached to your New York State CHAR 500 filing. If you were above $250,000 of revenue, you're required to have an audit done of your organization. What the law has done is they have raised those thresholds to higher significant amounts. I just want to take a step back for just one moment and just briefly discuss the difference between an audit and a review, because there may be some misconceptions there of what they represent and why you may want to have one versus the other, outside of the fact that the new law will require that. An audit is the highest level of auditing that can be done by a CPA, for an external independent CPA firm. And in an audit, that's an audit where we're looking at the books and records, where we are actually opining on the financial statements, rendering what we typically call a clean opinion or possibly a modified opinion, now call it unmodified. In that situation, we're looking at underlying documents to support the financial transactions, looking at the accounting policies and procedures, doing a number of substantive testing as well as analytical procedures, and also gaining a thorough understanding of your internal controls. In an audit, we don't necessarily opine or issue an opinion on your controls, but we do understand them to properly plan an audit. In a review, that internal control portion is much more reduced in terms of the work. We may ask some questions about controls, but we're not gaining a real thorough understanding relative to the audit procedures per se. In a review, it's more of a question and answer, analytical procedures, and sitting down with someone for a significant portion of time trying to understand the changes year over year of financial information on an aggregate level. So the significant type of difference between an audit function and a review function, they both have audit reports and opinions that come with an audit and a review, but they are different in scope, the difference in different in fee structure, obviously, and will be utilized for whatever the organization's purpose is. You may wish to have an audit done even though you are less than the required amounts now at this point in time. With regard to the new law effective July 1st, 2014, the review threshold is now $500,000 or below, and obviously the audit requirement is now $500,000 and above. And that's for July 1st, 2014. And those amounts increase in 2017 to $750,000 as a threshold. And eventually in 2021, I guess I'll still be working by then, not retired yet, up to $1 million. And there was a lot of deliberation that was done up in Albany about what the dollar threshold should be for a cutoff for an audit. There are other states in this country that have thresholds as high as $2 or $3 million. The State Society of CPAs in New York, our nonprofit committee, which I have been chairing, put a proposal into the state of about $2 million as a reporting threshold. But it was knocked down to $1 million at the outset of 2021. And again, there's a number of reasons why you may want to have an audit or a review done. The last piece I just want to add to the equation here is when the law goes into effect on July 1st, 2014, there's been a lot of misunderstanding as to what that date really means relative to the implementation as it relates to a financial statement audit. So the AG's office has set forth some guidance, it must be official guidance, that says that any tax return that is filed in New York State by a charity, a CHAR 500 fine that is submitted to New York State after July 1st, the new reporting thresholds are in place. So even if your year end is December 31st and you put your return on extension, you get that $500,000 threshold for the difference between audit and review functionality. So that's a little bit different. It's not, so you have a little bit of push out going out to that. So there's been some misconception. How does the year end work? How does reporting work? I'm glad to clarify that up with you. So, Larry?
Yeah, so basically if if you didn't have the requirement, I should say, if you did have the requirement to have an audit or review done, you were in 2013, tell your accountant to put you on extension. If he didn't already, that actually, which is 2 days, and actually puts you over the new threshold. And it was very, very liberal of the Attorney General to allow that. And the goal of that really, believe it or not, and I think as you see some of these rules, were to make it easier in a lot of ways for not-for-profits to comply with the rules, especially small ones. Now, let me also take a step back here. And a lot of the rules are like generic or told across the board. I think most people on the panel here would say a lot of the larger not-for-profits, forget one or two that you know have some are in the news with scandals, but for the most part, the larger not-for-profits, $1 million, $2 million, they've been following most of these rules for the last number of years. There hasn't been an issue. Where the problem comes in is on the smaller not-for-profits that they don't have the expertise, and they don't have people that can look into the rules. They're the ones that a lot of these rules are kicking into and making them comply with being fiduciarily responsible and the financial reporting requirements. And I'm going to kick right on to the board. What this law did is, and it was mentioned earlier, it's making the board a lot more responsible for what goes on with the organization, especially with the financial reporting. Now, if a number of you, can I just get a hand? How many people are on boards? A large number. How many deal with the financial information or view it? Okay. How many are an expert about financial reporting?
I better raise my hand.
That was really honest, I gotta say. Usually you get a half hand, very, very good. But I'm really glad that a lot of you are honest, because that's a fact. People that are on the board or are in charge of reviewing the financial information are not very knowledgeable, and they're doing the best they can with very limited information. This law is really tightening it up and saying, you're no longer iffy, you have to be responsible. Basically, the not-for-profit board is responsible for, and somebody mentioned Sarbanes-Oxley, and I have to state this, Sarbanes-Oxley is not applicable to not-for-profits in a lot of ways, although a lot of the rules have been filtering down. I get asked this by board members all the time. We must follow Sarbanes-Oxley. We must follow it. And sometimes that doesn't really help a small not-for-profit, so I wanted to just get that across. Although good practices, you might want to follow some of the rules. This is one of the rules. The board has to do certain things when it comes to dealing with the auditor. One, now, they have to be involved with hiring the auditor. Okay, they have to approve. Now remember, the board has to be, the people on the board who are making this decision have to be independent, which was discussed before, meaning no compensation. But they now have to approve the audit. And by the way, the rule states, although a lot of accountants don't like this, it has to be done annually now. So it has to be approved for the auditor. In addition, the board now has to review the findings of the auditor. Or when the auditor finishes their report, look over the report. That means that they can't just basically, get a report and go, oh, it looks good, it was signed by a CPA, okay. They have to review it, read at least some of the pages, and be somewhat familiar with it and basically approving the audit. Usually this fell on, you guys that are on boards know this, it usually fell on that one person on the board, maybe two, who had a little knowledge of accounting rules that pertain to not-for-profit. Now the whole board, you can't have the few people that, come, okay, I'll raise my hand and I'll prove it. You're more responsible. Legally now, you're more responsible. Ethically, you were before, now legally. Basically, they did give a little bit of leeway to smaller organizations. If you're under $10 million under the new rules, this rule of approving and reviewing the findings does not apply to January 1st, 2015. So the July 1st rule, they extended it out 6 months. It was mentioned before, I'm going to repeat this, the board has to be independent. And there are definitions in the new act of what constitute independence. The clearest one is that the people voting on the board can't be receiving any kind of compensation. And the only way that usually happens is the president on the board, the one who runs the board, is also the president of the organization and gets a salary. If you're getting a salary, it impinges your independence, and you cannot be the one voting on hiring or reviewing the auditor's findings. Also, the management letter at the end you should be reviewing. Now, if your annual income is over $1 million, and again, a lot of organizations have been complying with this, so if you're just going over the million, it's now going to be some new rules. The board has to do just a little bit more now. Not just do they have to hire the auditor and review their general findings, but they're supposed to now ask the auditor, and I'll use a technical term, the scope of what the auditor's doing. Now for you, you know, what does the scope mean? Basically, what are you doing? And David was explaining very briefly what an audit is. It has to explain, we are auditing the books. Okay, we are going to examine some of the documents. We're not checking every document because that's redoing the work. We're just going to selectively check some documents and provide some attestation, attesting, saying that your books are materially correct. That's one of the things. So, and how this is done, so you know, practically, the auditor is going to give something called an engagement letter, a contract that's going to state what the auditor is doing. Most auditors put in the engagement letter, that contract, what they're doing. We're going to audit the books, blah, blah, blah. That will suffice as the communication, but the people on the board, the members, the board members, trustees, should read this, and they have complied with that requirement as far as I'm understanding.
Or at least be provided a copy of the engagement letter for their reading pleasure.
And we'll have complied with this rule. Now, if you're over $1 million, here's a couple other things you have to do. You have to also ask, was there any problems during the audit? Were there any issues that came up with management? Was there information not provided to the auditor? Now, practically speaking, this is a problem. Because in the meeting, the executive director, the controller will be sitting there. And unless something is really egregious, it does put this person on the spot, meaning the auditor who has to work with the controller or the executive director. A common practice for large organizations could be followed from smaller ones, very simple, without insulting anybody. You ask the staff person, could you please step out of the room? We're not going to, you know, lambaste you or anything. Just please step out of the room. You can have an honest conversation then with the auditor and just ask them, hey guys, or hey guy, or woman, any issue came up? You know, you want to tell me that you didn't put down anything small that maybe we should know about, like your post-dating checks, you know, that we didn't hear about or something, which should have been in your letter anyway. Just a correspondence with the auditor. This is good practice, and you will cover your new obligation under the new law.
It's typically called an executive session at the end of the audit committee meeting.
And the only other thing to mention, under the new law, they talk about the word audit, audit committee. Audit committee, audit committee, audit committee. And somebody mentioned this earlier. If you have a board that has 8 people, your organization is 800,000, 500,000, you're lucky to have gotten 8 people, new board members on, and you have an executive committee, and you have a nominating committee member, and you have a finance budget committee. I get asked this question every couple of months. I'm sure David does too. Should we have an audit committee? And now under the new law, it says you should have an audit committee. My response to them back is, well, who are you going to put on the audit committee? Well, we have 3 people on the budget committee that really kind of know, so we'll put them on the audit committee. What's the point? Exactly. You're just, you know, switching hats. So I have a straightforward answer. Why don't you just call it the Budget, Finance, and Audit Committee? They said, well, that's no independence. Well, if the same people are on, it's not more independent. The key thing under the new law is the people on the audit committee that are approving the audit, and approving the auditors and review, they have to be independent. So if the audit committee is, if the same members and they're independent and not getting paid, they will comply with the rules. You don't have to have that word special audit committee, which really in practice doesn't accomplish anything. So I'm just mentioning that point comes up often about having the audit committee. And here's one last thing, and I'm going to turn it back to Dave. If you have an audit committee that's reviewing, approving the audit, and then reviewing their work, they must report to the full board what their decision is, and then the board should put it in the minutes that they reviewed what the audit committee has approved and has approved the audit committee's decision, or at least went along with it.
I just want to add just one last piece to what Larry mentioned, and I'm going to turn it back over to Larry again. With regard to the audit committee, the new provision does state that covered organizations must have an audit committee consisting of independent directors, as Larry just mentioned. But in lieu of that, you can have your actual board perform the function of an audit committee if you don't develop and separately designate through your governing documents an audit committee per se. But the challenge there is if you are utilizing your entire board as the audit committee, the whole concept of independence still comes into play. And those board members that are not deemed to be independent, as was defined earlier by our attorneys on the panel, that would create a problem relative to the approval of the audit process and the mechanisms that are set forth by the new act relative to the audit oversight provision. So, Larry?
Actually, that's leading right back into your area about the, basically about the independent board, which was actually covered a little bit. Independent directors was touched on by you guys a little bit. You want to touch on a little bit, David?
Well, we talked about independent directors earlier, I believe, right? Yeah, we did. So we can move. I mean, they can't be paid as an employee, can't have a relative who's receiving compensation as a key employee of the organization. And most recently, I've had several situations where we've had board members who either own companies or they're senior managements of maybe a financial institution or an insurance company or another provider, and that provider is providing services to the organization. There's compensation being paid in the back and forth, being paid out by the nonprofit for fees, for services being rendered. If those fees are greater than $25,000 or 2% of the gross revenue, that knocks down a member of not being independent and therefore creates trouble relative to the approval process.
Okay. This was also touched. I'm going to reiterate something because it's really important, especially organizations that are religious, some educational, that have real property. It was discussed, and I'm just going to repeat, bear with me, because it's such a major change, I think, to make it easier for not-for-profits. The requirement that if you had property and you were either merging or liquidating and you had to basically sell your property before you could liquidate or dissolve or merge or whatever, you had to get the approval of the, and you guys can correct me on this one, the Supreme Court. The Attorney General did not have any power to do that before. And I can tell you, I've been involved, and probably most people here, with not-for-profits, very small. They have a piece of property, a building, and they can't, it used to take a couple of years for them to close up to go through this process. Making this change where either two-thirds or a majority of the board, depending on their size, can vote on selling the assets. If it's major, obviously more members of the board have to approve it. And that the Attorney General can agree upon this was a major change, and they can prove it without going to the Supreme Court, which speed things up. And a lot of time, the sale of that property, the money is needed to fulfill certain requirements of the mission of the organization. So this was a major change and making it easier, especially for organizations that are doing mergers and liquidating.
Is there a provision that provides how long the Attorney General has to weigh in and approve?
I would use ASAP, but if you will never get the Attorney General to
I understand, but we can say how long it took previously. What can one expect in terms of a time frame?
I think all I could say is, without stepping on something I don't know about, it'll be faster.
Fair enough. Okay.
Here's a statement here's coming from the accountant. Very, very little resources, I should say, or attention is given, especially to small not-for-profits, for the accounting function. I'm making the statement. I've been teaching for 23 years. I've been lecturing for 25 years. And whenever and David also is teaching at NYU in a course, in a program that I developed, he hears this all the time. Constantly, people are raising the issues of, in the accounting department, of, you know what? Resources are not given, or we need extra people. Accounting is a support function. It's not the mission of the not-for-profit. It's not their purpose. Any support function always takes a backseat to doing the main mission of the organization.
Not Yahoo good, though.
I wouldn't say everybody, many people know this. And so what happens is, typically, especially a developing or a startup not-for-profit, it gets short-shifted, put back. The accounting program is put in late. Somebody volunteers to do it. They're a student at school, whatever. And it goes along like that for 6 months, a year, 2 years, until something happens. And something invariably happens where a foundation, which is a little more sophisticated in giving a grant, a donation, says, you know, let me look at your numbers. It doesn't make sense to me. Or a bank who might do a small credit line. Then all of a sudden, everybody scurries around and says, you know, we need to put in better procedures. We need to track our finances better. It is always short-shifted. And I know you're juggling with a lot of financing. All I can say to you is it shouldn't get as short-shifted as it does. And it should be given a little bit more attention. I don't say put all your resources, which are limited. Very, very important, especially under the new rules. Another thing I'm going to point, which now is even more important under the Revitalization Act, is that it's always been very difficult to get a good financial person on the board, somebody that understands reporting and accounting. To get an accountant on the board, whether they're familiar with not-for-profit or not, not-for-profit rules or GAAP, it is very difficult. Most of the people on the board that have some financial background take on this role. Very typically, and David, you can chime in, typically the person doing this role has some financial connection. They're a banker, maybe an insurance broker, somebody that deals with finances. They become the inherent board liaison to handling all the finances. It is very, very difficult. You can get an attorney on the board, will do pro bono work. You'll never get a CPA on the board to do pro bono work because they become the staff accountant. The Bar Association does recommend a certain amount of pro bono work. Unfortunately, the AICPA does not require this or recommend it. So it is a very difficult thing. But if all possible, there is a big push now at the membership organization, the professional ones, to get accountants more involved on not-for-profit. And I'm seeing more CPAs getting on. If you can find somebody that's an accounting degree or a CPA, even better, and you can cajole them, to be on the board, it will really serve you extremely well. Right. On that note, David,
I think we should open up the floor to some questions. Does anyone have? We have about 7-8 minutes to. Does anyone have any questions? Yes, sir, in the back.
What you're addressing is the rules that came out of Executive Order 38, which was signed by the governor sometime in 2013, effective in the year that we're sitting in presently in right now, a fiscal year 2014. They are separate and apart from the Revitalization Act. Executive Order 38 set rules on compensation and rules on administrative or programmatic spending as compared to administrative overhead for those organizations that are funded by Medicaid or other New York State government-funded avenues in excess of $500,000. And that you are correct in that regard, though. The threshold is going from 25 to 20 to 15 over the next 3 years, and it will make it harder and harder for nonprofits who are funded by New York State through the contract or through the Medicaid program to be able to comply with those particular rules. So looking at your administrative costs, and by the way, the calculations set forth by New York State for that are different than what you may think is an overhead in a cost reporting world. So you need to take a look and understand what those methodologies are, because there are some things that are in administration now for cost reporting, which are actually programmatic for purposes of the calculation.
Yes, sir.
The Lawyers Alliance of New York has issued some templates already.
That's great. Yes, in the back, with the striped shirt.
Hi, I'm Danielle.
that's great, valuable technical assistance. Leslie?
I actually have two questions related to the related party transactions. A lot of times we'll partner with other Brooklyn nonprofits that transactions that don't involve the exchange of money, but involve the exchange of value. Is that something that we need to think of as a possible area of conflict? So we'll have interlocking board members.
Well, it's really going to be a facts and circumstances analysis. If there's any financial give and take, then certainly you're going to have to focus on that. I did have some organizations in the past where there were overlapping boards, and they were making decisions about whether to merge or whether to work together on things, and they did follow the conflicts of interest procedures out of an abundance of safety. The laws very much focus on financial transactions. However, your conflicts of interest policy could also define what a conflict is broader than a financial transaction. So some of it is looking at the documents that you have in place already to see if it falls under it.
Can I just want to follow up one thing about related party transactions? It's a common misconception among nonprofits that related partners aren't necessarily bad transactions,
right,
nor are they prohibitive transactions. But there are certain rules and requirements that have been in place for many years now and are now more strict in New York State with the new Revitalization Act that governing boards have to follow and adhere to. You may enter into it, you may find a transaction maybe most beneficial to your organization, maybe the most cost effective, and receive the best value or best service. And it happens to be someone from a board member's company. It may happen to be that way. But just make sure you comply with the standards in the act and that there's recusement of the individual, and it goes through the proper protocols and approvals as documented in the minutes to those meetings. So if someone does look at it, it can be identified that you did follow the proper rules.
And just to add one other little piece to that, when he says recuse it, the practical way to do it is basically if somebody is going to provide legal service and on the board, they could present, I'm going to do this and I'm going to give it free, and that's fine. Recusing just for practical means after they present whatever they need to present, walk out of the room and let the board make the decision. Don't be sitting there when, and this is not arbitrary, this is in the act. It's very clear.
What, yes.
I'll just mention one thing. The entire board definition, you know, there are three ways to get to the entire board, and one benefit of the act, so you can really figure out what is a quorum, what is the majority or an entire board, or any if you need unanimous consent. But nonprofits without members now, as opposed to before, even though some nonprofits without members may have put this in their bylaws anyway, can now legally specify in their bylaws a range for the number of directors. So instead of it being tied to the actual number that may be in the bylaws, now it could be within that range, and that is tied to the number of directors elected as of the last board election, which really gives, I think, an incredible amount of flexibility of what the entire board means. And I'll mention something that what's interesting is in the real estate transaction section of the act in section 509, where I said that you just need a simple majority of the board, that is one of the only places where it says a majority of the board. It doesn't say the entire board. And so I think there really is this question of what the intent was there, and hopefully it'll be confirmed. Was it to be just the majority of the board members that happened to be at that meeting, or did they really mean to say a majority of the entire board? And it would be the same concept for the committee approvals on that particular topic.
We have a couple more. Denise?
Separate and apart audit committee
members of board members? Does the law address this issue?
Use a microphone.
I'll tell you, and then David can tell you from this experience. The law does not specify that you have to do it. I think they're really talking about very large organizations that, not necessarily numbers, but to have so many board members that, as opposed to a membership organization like the Brooklyn Chamber, that has members that are active, but really organizations that really have seven, eight different board committees. My personal feeling, since the Act doesn't specify, setting up a separate audit committee where it's difficult to find expertise there, and then they have to communicate with the budget committee, make sure they're complying in the finance, I don't see the necessity as long as the members are all independent. If they're independent on the board, on the budget and finance, they also could be the audit committee. And I think it works smoothly with organizations that have trouble getting people to be active in this area. So no, it doesn't specify, and I don't necessarily recommend it unless there's really, the organization is so large that you really want that check and balance of an audit committee reviewing the other committee's work.
The membership of the audit committee is not specified in the law, and that is accurate. The law does state audit committees are required of organizations now in New York State, or the board can function in the capacity as an audit committee. But your governing documents have to stipulate who's responsible for the audit oversight function of the organization. Depending on the size of your organization, depending on the makeup of your board, whether it's the entire board or a separate audit committee, you have to at least address that concept now within the new act as of July 1st.
Okay, I'll have the last question here.
So that's a really good question, and I think we're hoping to get some advice and counsel on that from the Attorney General. There's two places in the whistleblower law where volunteers come into play, aside from directors. One is that any volunteer can blow the whistle. So essentially, any volunteer anybody who's doing volunteer work for you will have the right to follow your whistleblower policies and make a complaint if they see something that they think is inappropriate. The second place that it comes into play is really your burden on handing out this policy to your volunteers, because you know if you have hundreds and hundreds of volunteers, you may not want to be handing it out to all of them. And the law talks about the requirement that you hand it out only to volunteers who provide substantial services, which is undefined, unfortunately, and hopefully will become defined. But I would not anticipate that would be every single volunteer that walks through the door.
Complicated. Okay. With that, I want to thank all our panelists and thank you for the great questions. And we have a short break before the next.
Yes, panel. Thank you. Let's give Anthony and the entire panel a round of applause. I think I share the sentiment of all of you that I am still confused, but that's okay.
It's not good.
I have only had one cup of coffee, so that could be it. But what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to ask Rick and our grants person at the chamber to reach out to all of you, if it's okay, and just get maybe an email with some of the notes that you've talked about. We at the chamber will then compile a report. We'll get it out to everyone who registered today. We'll post it on our website, and then we'll ask all of you in organizations to post it out there. Anna at Investors said she would share it with their nonprofits. I would ask all of you to do the same. And then this way, it can just become a living document, and people will at least have some answers.